Good morning, everyone. I'm going to be on for early just to make sure that people get on. It's about 7 minutes to 10, but we're just going to listen to a little bit of Sidewalk Prophets off of my Spotify. I have three screens growing. I have one with my laptop, and then I have two cameras on me, one for Eden and one for Osage UCC. So blessings to all of you, and just sit back and listen to some music while we wait for people to join us. Also, if you would like to share this video on your Facebook page to get more representation for our churches and or myself, I would appreciate that. Just go ahead and share and like, and that way we get our name out there. Yes, I am dealing with a cold, and I haven't had a cold, I don't think, in like 4 years, honestly. So this is crazy. My voice is a little raspy, and my left ear is not doing so well. It's a little plugged, but I welcome you all to worship, and we'll get started here in about 5 minutes. So in that time, you have time to go get a hot cocoa, a hot coffee, a latte, whatever you choose to drink for this morning to stay warm. I haven't looked at the temperature lately, but I think at 8 o'clock this morning, it was a negative 14 or 15 degrees outside, and that was without the wind chill. There's a drift outside my north door where Theo goes out, and the drift is a little taller than what Theo is standing up. So I'll get a picture here later today and get it up there on Facebook. So, but again, if you want to share these videos, I would appreciate it to get our name out there. And like I said, I just wanted to get us started early so that people could find us and get logged in on time so that they don't miss anything. We don't want to miss church, do we? And I can't see comments on the two camera screens for Osage and Eden, but I can tell who's watching, I can see how many are logged in, and we only have a few right now, so. So I hope they come back. I know somebody had logged in earlier on the Osage one, and now they're gone again. So.
Still awake, so I picked up a pen and a page, and I started writing just what I'd say if we were face to face. I tell you just what you mean to me, tell you these simple truths. Be strong in the Lord and never give up hope.
I know, waiting is the hardest thing, but see, normally, good morning, everyone who's saying good morning to me. Normally, we would be in like a prelude situation where you'd be talking in the sanctuary, and it's really weird to not be talking to someone right now, isn't it? You're in your house, if you live alone. I've got Theo behind me. He's passed out on the floor. He's enjoying this warmth of the day, staying home. Like I said, I've got three screens going right now. I have two cameras on me up top of my computer, and their iPads are off to the sides of me. And then I have my computer straight in front of me as well. So it's a little weird to see me out of the corner of my eyes. But I welcome you all to what will be our morning worship devotion. It's not going to be a normal one that you all probably want or whatever, but it will be worship, and you will hear God's word today. We've got about 30 more seconds, and we'll get started. All right. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to my worship service this morning. For whoever is watching on my Facebook page, welcome, and I welcome you also then to our Eden Presbyterian Church worship, along with my Osage United Church of Christ worship. As I was saying in the time before we actually started, it is 10 o'clock now, and I just welcome you in to this time of prayer, devotion, a little bit of scripture reading from the Gospel of Mark. We're talking about baptism today. So if you heard about baptism last week, you can stay, or if you feel like you know everything about baptism, then you can go on your way. But some of us ministers, we follow the lectionary. And if you follow the lectionary, they would have wanted us to skip Epiphany, but I did Epiphany last week. And today would be baptism, and we're going out of the Gospel of Mark. And so let us join just in a couple of words. I bought this book called Jesus Calling from Sarah Young. It's Enjoying Peace in His Presence. It looks like this. And there are a couple of things that I want to read out of here for today. She's got daily devotions, and I'm going to start back on Friday, where she says this.
Let me prepare you for the day that stretches out before you. I know exactly what this day will contain, whereas you have only vague ideas about it. You would like to see a map showing all the twists and turns of your journey. You'd feel more prepared if you could somehow visualize what is on the road ahead. However, there is a better way to be prepared for whatever you will encounter today. Spend quality time with me, God. I will not show you what is on the road ahead, but I will thoroughly equip you for the journey. My living presence is your companion each step of the way. Stay in continual communication with me, whispering my name whenever you need to redirect your thoughts. My living presence is your companion each step of the way. Thus, you can walk through this day with your focus on me. My abiding presence is the best roadmap available. And on Saturday, she wrote this. And of course, they are out of scripture. And this one comes from Psalm 118. Try to view each day as an adventure, carefully planned out by your guide. Instead of staring into the day that is ahead of you, attempting to program it according to your will, be attentive to God and to all I have prepared for you. Thank God for this day of life, recognizing that it is precious, unrepeatable gift. Trust that I am with you each moment, whether you sense my presence or not. A thankful, trusting attitude helps you to see events in your life from my perspective. A life lived close to God will never be dull or predictable. Expect each day to contain surprises. Resist your tendency to search for the easiest route through the day. Be willing to follow wherever I lead, no matter how steep or treacherous the path before you. The safest place to be is by my side. And then for today, January 14th, which is so fitting for today, because it is something that we all need to hear in a way that blesses us, in a way that calls us to God's Spirit. And she writes this on a reflection from 1 Samuel 16:7 and Romans 8:38 to 39. Let me bless you with my grace and peace. Open your heart and mind to receive all that I have for you. Do not be ashamed of your emptiness. Instead, view it as the optimal condition for being filled with my peace. It is easy to touch up your outward appearance, to look as if you have it all together. Your attempts to look good can fool most people, but I see straight through you, into the depths of your being. There is no place for pretense in your relationship with me. Rejoice in the relief of being fully understood. Talk with me about your struggles and feelings of inadequacy. Little by little, I will transform your weaknesses into strengths. Remember that your relationship with me is saturated in grace. Therefore, nothing that you do or don't do can separate you from my presence. Again, these words were from Sarah Young in Jesus Calling, Enjoying Peace in His Presence. And if you missed me announce, the music that we were listening to were from Sidewalk Prophets, and they are a contemporary band that provides us with uplifting words. So today we are reading the Gospel of Mark, and let me start actually with Psalm 29. That also goes with today's readings. And let us take a moment to hear what David had for us today. The theme is that God reveals his great power in nature. We can trust God to give us both the peace and the strength to weather the storms of life. And so David wrote this psalm, Psalm 29. Ascribe to the Lord, you heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in his splendor of his holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The glory of God thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks in pieces the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon leap like a calf, Syrian like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord strikes with flashes of lightning. The voice of the Lord shakes the desert. The Lord shakes the desert of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord twists the oaks and strips the forest bare. And in his temple, all cry glory. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord is enthroned as king forever. The Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord blesses his people with peace. And then turning to Mark 1, verse 4. We're going to start at verse 4 and go to 14. Or verse 11, my bad. 4 through 11. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message. After me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. And at that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." This ends the reading from the Gospel of Mark. May these words enter our hearts and our minds, and may they open our ears to hear this message. Will you pray with me? Holy and gracious Spirit, we thank you for being in this presence today, this time of being online and welcoming the online community to gather in this time and space. Enter and filter through these lines of communication like you have in the past. Do it today, Lord. Bring your healing upon those who are needing healed. Bring your word to those who are truly needing to hear you today. So, Lord, send that Holy Spirit upon us into the depths of our hearts, into the depths of our minds, opening our ears to hear the message you have for us today. And Lord, I ask, may the words of my mouth and the meditations upon all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So as we come online today, I do not truly have something very well prepared because most of my preparation was more for being in the church. And so as I think about baptism, we think about water. And a lot of people like to know that there's holy water somewhere in the church so that they can be baptized. Well, the funny thing about holy water, and maybe it's not so funny, is that it's only holy when it's blessed. I literally take tap water out to the baptismal font, make sure it's warm, and when I pray over it, then it becomes holy water. I take it out with my hand and I pour it on the child's head, whether it's a baby, a teenager. I have done an adult, a couple of them actually. And baptism is one of those things where a lot of people are like, well, who can baptize and who can, you know, make it holy and this, that, and the other thing. You know, Jesus came to John. John was a prophet. He was a, you know, he was the Baptist. He was the one that was before Jesus. He was Jesus's cousin. And he predicted, or he took Isaiah's prediction. Isaiah predicted John to come before Jesus, and he was going to make sure that the people knew that Jesus was coming, that it was something real, that something was like going to be in front of them, and somehow they needed to realize it. And so John preached the way of repentance. Repent of your sins, be baptized by me, and you are going to truly be a part of this follower. And so a lot of the times we ask, well, what can we do to prepare the way for Jesus? Well, we just got done with the season of Advent. And Advent is one of those times where we are to prepare our hearts, clear our junk out of there that has just festered and built up for time and time again. And guess what? In 30 days, literally 30 days from today, February 14th, we start the season of Lent. And so we don't have a lot of time to build up ugly stuff since Christmas. And so, again, we just need to keep on that path of righteousness, that path of being told to repent, to turn away. So I read from the Life Application Study Bible, and they have a ton of footnotes in, which I like to read, and I like to give it to you because not all of us have this opportunity. But it asks the question from verse 4, why does the Gospel of Mark begin with the story of John the Baptist and not mention the story of Jesus's birth? So we have to remember that Mark was a different time. It is actually the oldest gospel written, and so Matthew did not come before Mark, and if you didn't know that, now you know. And we have to remember that it's important that Roman officials on this day were always preceded by an announcer or herald. And when the herald arrived in town, the people knew that someone in prominence was coming. And so because Mark's audience was primarily Roman Christian, he began the book with John the Baptist, whose mission it was to announce the coming of Jesus. And so most important, it was the coming of Jesus to know that he was the most important man who ever lived. And Roman Christians would have, would have been less important or less interested in Jesus's birth than his message. This is what happens when you have sinus drainage. And so in John's ministry, baptism was a visible sign that a person who decided to follow John and to follow his repentance of sin, they were going to change his life or change their life by getting baptized. They were going to give up the sinful ways, the selfish ways, and they were turning to God. And so John took a known custom and he gave it new meaning. The Jews were often baptized. The Jews often baptized were non-Jews who had converted to Judaism, but to baptize a Jew was a sign of repentance, was radical from the Jewish tradition. And so the early church took baptism a step further and they associated it with Jesus's death and resurrection. And so Jesus came in a time of history when the entire civilized world was relatively peaceful under Roman rule. Travel was easy. There was a common language. And the news about Jesus' life, death, and resurrection could spread quickly through this vast Roman Empire. In Israel, people were ready for Jesus to come. And they flocked to hear John. There had been no God, quote unquote, no God sent prophet for 400 years. And since the days of Malachi, who actually wrote the last book of the Old Testament. And so they were anticipating, they were growing, they were wanting this great prophet or a Messiah to be prophesied, like what it was saying in the Old Testament, that they would come, he would come, he would save them. And so the purpose of John preaching was to prepare the people, to prepare them to accept God's only Son, Jesus. And so when John challenged them to confess their sins individually, he signaled the start of a new way to relate to God. Now, is change needed in our life before we can hear and understand Jesus' message? I would say yes, because we have to admit that we need forgiveness before we can accept his message of love and grace and forgiveness. And so to prepare for Christ, we need to repent. Turn away from the world's dead-end attractions, sinful temptations, harmful attitudes, and turn to God, for he can give us a new start. We just started a new year, a new start. And so when John said Jesus would baptize them with the Holy Spirit, sending the Holy Spirit to live within each believer, to which we all have. John's baptism with water prepared a person to receive Christ's message. And so the baptism demonstrated repentance, humility, and a willingness to turn from sin. This was the beginning of the spiritual process. And when Jesus baptizes with Holy Spirit, the entire person is transformed by the Spirit's power. Jesus offers us both forgiveness of sin and the power to live for him. If John's baptism was for repentance from sin, why was Jesus baptized? And I get that question a lot. Jesus was a perfect man, right? That's what we're told. That's what we believe. That's what we honor. Well, even the greatest prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, had to confess their sinfulness and a need to repent. So Jesus didn't need to admit sin. And he didn't need forgiveness. But he was baptized for the following reasons. One, to begin his mission to bring the message of salvation to all people. All people. There's not somebody out there that doesn't need baptism. No one is excluded from Jesus' baptism. Number two, to show support for John's ministry. He appreciated what John was doing. They were cousins. And so he wanted people to know that Jesus believed what John was doing. And so he needed to let the people see it. Number three, he needed to be baptized to identify with our humanness and sin. He wanted the people to know that he understood. And number four, he gave us an example to follow. We know that John's baptism was different from Christian baptism in the church because Paul had John's followers baptized again. You can read that in Acts 19, verses 2 and 5. So then there becomes the discussion of, is immersion baptism better than in sprinkling? I don't sprinkle. I literally take my hand, and I have a big hand, and I cup that water and I pour it on that child and on the head, and they are drowning when they're done. I've had conversation with parents a couple of times, you know, is it okay to do a child's baby's baptism? Because in their belief, the baby is born without sin, and yet they're born into sin. And so when we baptize, or when I baptize a baby, I always make sure that they understand that it's not only for the child, but it's for the parents and the godparents and for the congregation to understand how this child is being accepted into God's body of Christ, God's family of Christ, and how Jesus is. It's not so much forgiveness of sin, but it's showing support, like Jesus did, support for John's ministry. And so it's that example. I don't know if I'm a fan of what Paul did, rebaptizing John's followers, because I believe once we're baptized, honestly, I do. Now I understand maybe why he did it, because John's followers' baptisms were different in the Christian baptism, but Jesus was baptized by John. He didn't get rebaptized. And honestly, in my faith, I guess my reaffirmation of baptism comes from when I was confirmed. Those questions that my parents and godparents answered at my baptism when I was 1 month old in January of 1976 are the same questions that I ask at confirmation. Do you reaffirm your baptismal vows? And they are these. They are also the same questions that come with becoming a new member in a church. And what is awesome about sharing the Christian relationship with our partners in Christ across denominations, from Catholics to Lutherans to Presbyterians to Disciples of Christ to the United Church of Christ to the Methodists to a few other Protestant churches that I'm forgetting right now. But we share in the communion, and our baptisms are recognized. We don't have to be rebaptized to belong. In the past, you had to belong to a church. Well, what church are you belonging to? I belong to the Church of Jesus Christ. I don't belong to a United Church of Christ. I don't belong to a Presbyterian church. I don't belong to a Catholic church. I belong to the Church of Jesus Christ. And that's how we baptized. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And I think that's where a lot of people struggle with their baptisms, because people believe that they're baptized into a certain church denomination. And if that's what you're believing and that's what you're being told, I don't believe that. I baptize because in Matthew, at the end of Matthew, Jesus says, go and baptize and make disciples. He didn't say go baptize in the name of a church and make disciples. God loves us. God loved his son. And he sent his son to be with us. He identified his humanness with us. And we are so grateful. I have to share one more story about a baptism. I, as some of you know, was down in Cahokia, Missouri for 7 years. And I baptized cousins. Excuse me. I'm sorry. This is what colds do for you. And again, I haven't had a cold in like years. So I forgot what they're like. Anyway, these two cousins, and they were daughters, and they were about, I think they're about 6 months old. And one of them was just happy-go-lucky and doing everything and everything right. And she was accommodating. And I have some St. Paul people on my feed right now. And they might remember these two little girls. And the other little girl, oh, she was screaming bloody murder. She was red in the face, and she just did not want anything to do with this, especially coming up front and being in front of the crowd. And her mother turned to her sister. The moms were sisters. So, and she goes, I bet we're going to see steam roll off that child's head. Oh, how funny. They are now 5 years old, and they are living in the Chicago area. And just the other, I don't know, about a month ago, the mother posted about this little girl and how she is just like warming people's hearts and so caring with her siblings. And somebody said something about, oh, she's just got such a warm heart. And my comment to that was, well, the baptism took. And the mother goes, that is the funniest thing I've heard in a long time. And she says, that is going to be her father and I's new tagline, the baptism took. Oh, they're such precious children. Anyway, it doesn't matter if the child is screaming bloody murder or if the child is pleasant and willing to just do what happens. Jesus says, come. Come to the water and be filled with life. He said that many times in his ministry. And so as we remember this day of our baptism, whether you were a child, a baby, an adult, maybe you haven't been baptized yet, and so I encourage you to be baptized in the name of God. Come to his water of forgiveness and life, because he will give you life. That's what it's about, being filled with that Holy Spirit. I encourage you to do that this day, to think about and to really be encouraged by Mark's words of why Jesus did it. To honor John's baptism, to show us his humanness, and to show us what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Let us give thanks to God. Amen. And so now, this is the time where I ask that you think about sending your offerings and tithes into the churches, whether you're at Eden Presbyterian Church or Osage United Church of Christ. Remember to give. just because you weren't in worship this morning, please be sure to give next week and add today's offering into it that you would normally give. Our ministry and mission depends on it, and we ask that you just do what you can. And so please do so. Another thing that I need to remind us all is that next week on the 21st, Osage is going to have their annual meeting. So those of you watching, please remember that your annual meeting will be next week during worship at 9 a.m. And also that the 28th, Eden, will have your annual meeting during worship at 10:30. The books will be ready for UCC, hopefully this week. They're ready to print. We just haven't had time to get them printed because of the weather. And Eden's, you'll be ready hopefully this week as well. Those are the announcements. And so before we go today, let us join in a word of prayer and honor our God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Holy and gracious God, we come to you today and we give thanks for hearing this message about baptism, about why Jesus was baptized by John, and about how our own baptism can reflect that Holy Spirit within us. We talk a lot, Lord, about our light shining. And so we ask that you help us to continue to let that light shine within us. On this frigid day, Lord, we ask that you keep all of us safe from frostbite or sometimes worse. We ask that you be with those who are homeless, who are struggling to find heat and shelter, warm clothes, warm socks, shoes, maybe even a meal to eat today. It is not good and it's not safe for anybody to be outside long. So Lord, we ask that you keep them protected. Lord, we also ask that you be with all of our loved ones today who are struggling with an illness, with a cold, someone near and dear to a congregation's member's heart. We pray, Lord, for Julie. And we ask that your spirit be with her. Be with Julie's family and friends, Lord, and just help them feel comforted in this time of transition as Julie is on hospice or comfort care. Lord, we pray for all who are in need of your healing, who are in need of the words to trickle into their hearts, to open up those hearts for love. Lord, we pray for our men and women of the military and their families. And Lord, we pray for all of our leaders. We also ask, Lord, that you be with all of our loved ones in the nursing homes, especially those at Evergreen, Faith Assisted Living, at Faith Lutheran Home, at Osage Rehab, and at Apple Valley, and for those at the Norris Springs Nursing Home. And Lord, we just continue to ask that you keep everyone safe on the roads. And we thank you for our first responders and our people who are moving the snows and out there diligently trying to keep the roads safe. And Lord, with these concerns brought to you, we also lift you the joys of laughter, the joys of love, the joy of being able to be online together, even though it can be a hindrance at times. But when electronics work, Lord, it is amazing to stay connected with you and with each other. We give you thanks, O Lord, and we come to you with the prayer that your Son taught his disciples to pray, and we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Thank you so much for watching this morning. May you be blessed by hearing these words. And if you are in the area, I encourage you next week to join us at Osage United Church of Christ at 9 a.m. Sunday morning at 630 State Street in Osage, Iowa, or at Eden Presbyterian Church at 10:30 a.m. at 3105 Glass Avenue in Rudd, Iowa. Or you can always find us on our Facebook pages at Osage United Church of Christ or Eden Presbyterian Church. May you stay warm this day, and may you have a wonderful, wonderful Sunday and a wonderful week. God's blessings to you all. Amen.